So it is our pleasure today to welcome Clotilde L'Aigle, who is at IAP. Clotilde did her PhD with Henry McCracken and myself on large-scale structure and galaxy formation. She then did a postdoc in Oxford with Adrian Sliese and Julien Devrient, and then got a position back at IAP last year. So she's going to tell us about galaxy formation and the cosmic web. She's an expert in galaxy formation, and one of her skills is the ability to analyze both hydrodynamical simulations and large-scale surveys, which allows her to do a more thorough investigation of biases. So I guess thank you again.
Thank you, Christoph. Okay, so let me start with a very impressive fact, which is that soon, so in one or two decades maybe, we'll have observed almost every Milky Way-like galaxies we can observe in the universe. So for illustration, I show here the Euclid mission sky coverage after 6 years of mission. And for reference, I show the mass completeness of the survey as a function of redshift. And what we see is that, so if we look at the red line, which corresponds to a set. Okay, it works. Okay, if we look at the red line, which corresponds to a selection in the near infrared at 24 in magnitude. Sorry. Okay, I will not use this. Okay. Oui, c'est ce que je vais faire. Non, mais il est déjà off, en fait. Je vais utiliser juste le laser, il n'y a pas de souci. We see that by up to redshift 2.5, we can observe all the galaxies down to the 10 to the 10 solar mass, which is very impressive. And also, we'll have other surveys like WFIRST, LSST, SphereX, which will complement this impressive data set. Yet, there are some basic questions which are not satisfactorily answered. So we know that galaxies are very diverse in terms of shapes and colors. And we know that we need to account for this diversity when we make large surveys. So for example, if I have a survey which targets specifically red galaxies, I will not necessarily trace the same structures as a survey which targets specifically blue galaxies, because red and blue galaxies do not necessarily live in the same environment. And also, for example, red and blue galaxies will not be aligned in the same way with the large-scale structure, so they will have different intrinsic alignment patterns, and we need to account for this when, for example, we make lensing surveys. So we know this. And so we know that we need to model correctly the abundance of passive and star-forming galaxies as a function of mass and redshifts. And we understand galaxy formation to some extent. We understand star formation in galaxies, and we know a lot about quenching processes. But still, we are not yet able to correctly predict the abundance, so the correct abundance of passive and star-forming galaxies, so of blue and red galaxies, at all masses at all redshift. For illustration, I show here this SFR versus stellar mass in the SDSS at redshift zero. So you see this main sequence of star-forming galaxies. And here at high mass and low star formation rate, we have the sequence of passive galaxies. And I show here the same diagram in the Illustris TNG simulation, also at redshift zero, and this is great because we also have the main sequence of star-forming galaxies, and we have also a population of passive galaxies which are shifted here because of the resolution issue, okay, but it's still there. So we are able to produce a population of passive galaxies, but still the details do not really match. For example, if we look at where the bulk of the star-forming galaxies lie in this 2D plane, in the SDSS, it's here. And this point corresponds to this point in the illustrious TNG diagram. So they are off in both in stellar mass and star formation rate to predict where the bulk of star-forming galaxies lie. So this motivates us to look further at what are the quenching processes in galaxies. And that will be the topic of my talk. In particular, I will look at the impact of the large-scale environment in shaping the diversity of galaxies. Okay. What I show here is the halo distribution in the Horizon Agen simulation in the small sub-box of the simulation. I show this because we know that at first order, the halo mass regulates galaxy growth. Okay, it will regulate the mode of gas accretion onto the galaxies, and also the efficiency of AGN feedback, for example. But still, if we look at this halo, for example, the halo in the red box, this halo have more or less the same mass, but if we look at the distance to the closest halo, that we can take as a proxy of density, we see that this halo live in a different density environment. This will be high density, intermediate density, and low density. Okay? And we know that at a given halo mass, we still have a diversity of galaxy properties, which might be driven by these different density environment. And we know for a long time that local density also shape halo properties beyond what is driven by halo mass. And the basic first-order explanation is that halo which live in over-density will have formed earlier, and then and then galaxies within them are more evolved, so they are more likely to be passive, for example. But still, so this is known from a long time, the effect of halo mass and the effect of local density. But still, with this, we are not completely able to understand the transformation of galaxies, which motivates us to look further. And if we look at this distribution, we see that the halo are not uniformly distributed, right? They are distributed along this filamentary structure, which is the cosmic web. And we have good reason to think that cosmic web will impact the transformation of galaxies beyond what is driven by halo mass and local density. So I have overplotted on this halo distribution. These white lines here is the skeleton as traced by the dark matter particles in the simulation. So how the skeleton, so this is basically the locus of the filaments, the geometrical location of the filaments. So the code identify the peaks in the density field and the saddle points, which are local maxima along one or two direction and minima along the other direction. And basically, it connects the saddle points to the nodes following the gradients of the density. So this allows to identify the location of the cosmic web filaments. And I have overplotted the gas density field. So this is this colorful material. And we see that these filaments are the gas reservoir, as you can expect, gas is denser in filaments. I have also overplotted these lines, which are the gas velocity field lines, which are color-coded by vorticity. So whiter colors are vorticity-rich, corresponds to vorticity-rich gas. And what we see is that in filaments, the gas is vorticity-rich. So there are two things. The filaments are the gas reservoir, and the properties of the gas will depend so on the cosmic web environment, but also the kinematics of the gas and the geometry of the accretion. And this is likely to shape the accretion history onto halo and then onto galaxy, and then to shape their properties. So before moving further, let me highlight a few facts about the cosmic web. The first one is that the cosmic web is a multiscale structure, and we need to account for that. So, for example, if I take a halo, which is not on these cosmic filaments, but a bit further away, this halo is still likely to be connected to smaller scale filaments, like tendrils, okay, tendrils, but which do not appear in this extraction because I have done the extraction by filtering the low scale structure. Also, let me emphasize the fact that the halo, I mean, the filaments which are traced by the galaxies or by the halos are not necessarily identical to those traced by the gas or from the dark matter distribution itself. And this is important because in observational surveys, we'll extract filaments which are, in most of the cases, at least at low redshift, which are traced by the galaxy distribution. Okay, and so we need to account for this. When we interpret the result. Observationally speaking, it's quite difficult to extract the filaments from surveys because we need a good sampling to accurately constrain the position of the filaments. And also we need accurate redshift. So now we start to have data which are good enough for this extraction. So I will show some work based on observation, but this is quite a recent step. Okay, in our interpretation of galaxy evolution. And as I said, so this is difficult, so that's why current observations are mostly limited to low redshift for now. And I will advocate for pushing further this study at higher redshift. So during this talk, I will first discuss the galaxy transformation in filaments, then galaxy transformation at the node. We'll emphasize some processing happening at the nodes, and then I will make forecasts for cosmic web reconstruction at high redshift. I distinguish galaxy transformation in filaments and nodes because the geometry of the accretion will be really different, right? In filaments, we have a very anisotropic environment, while at the node, we can have several filaments connecting to the nodes. This is a more isotropic environment, and what will matter will maybe be more the number of connected filaments than the proximity to a given filament. Okay. So over the past years, we have seen a lot of observational works trying to investigate how galaxy properties change as a function of the proximity to cosmic filaments. To give you an idea of the kind of signal we get, I will briefly detail what we did in the cosmos field. I will also explain what we did in cosmos field because this is a work based on photometric data, and this is potentially something that we can do later with Euclid, or at least in the Euclid deep field, when we'll have a complementary very deep optical data, which will be very useful to get accurate photometric redshift. So cosmos is a 2-square-degree field on the sky. It has been imaged by a lot of different telescopes, so we sample quite well the electromagnetic magnetic spectra of the galaxies, which is important to get accurate photometric redshift. You might remember this plot I showed for Euclid at the beginning of the talk. So this is what we have in cosmos. The mass limit as a function of redshift is the orange line. Euclid will correspond more or less to the green line, okay? So in the cosmos field, we have extracted the photometry of the galaxies, so we get photometric redshift and photometric masses. Now, I will stack the galaxy distribution into these slices, the thickness of which is calibrated on the accuracy of the photometric redshift. I compute the density from the galaxy distribution, so this is a triangulation on the galaxy distribution, and then I extract filaments in the same way as I described before with the disperse code. We look at different galaxy properties in filament. I will just... I forgot to say that. So we extract these filaments. But there is no guarantee that we are extracting really filaments. We could maybe only work on nodes, right? So we need to validate this extraction. So to validate the extraction, we worked with mock photometric catalog. And importantly, we also cross-correlated the filament distribution as extracted by galaxies with independent data sets, in particular with X-ray group identification on Cosmos, and we found that most of the time the X-ray group were falling at the nodes of the cosmic web as extracted from the galaxy distribution, which is an a posteriori validation of the extraction. So let me just detail this signal. Okay, so we look at how the proximity to filaments segregate or shape the transformation from star forming to passive. So what we found is that passive galaxies are more likely to be closer to the filament backbones than star-forming galaxies. I show here the distribution of the distance to filaments for the passive galaxies and the star-forming one. And if we look at the median of the distribution, passive are slightly closer to filaments than star-forming. And this is a result which is also found in other observational surveys. So now we need to ask why this signal does happen. And the first thing you can say is that it is just driven by density, right? I say that density has an impact on the abundance of passive galaxies, and filaments are denser. So the signal of the impact of the proximity to filaments might just be driven by the fact that filaments are denser. So this is a very perfectly fair point. And to check for this, we remove the effect of density. So here I show the distance to filament as a function of density. So you see this correlation as we expect, but there is still a quite large scatter. So what we do is that in a given density bin, we reshuffle the distance to filaments. And if the signal is identical, it means that everything in my signal is driven by density. And it does not matter if this overdensity is a filament or a node, okay? And when we do that, we get the dashed line signal, which is weaker than the signal we had before, which is an indication that there is an effect of proximity to filament which comes on top of the effect of the density. So what is the reason for the measured excess of massive and passive galaxies in filaments? So I keep this first point because you can say that because we are working in observational surveys, there are a lot of uncertainties, and maybe we do not remove well the effect of density. And so this is fair, and we will need a very large sample to probe accurately each degree of freedom, right, to disentangle effect of density and effect of distance to filament. But we can think to other reasons. You can say that by redshift zero, the gas in filament will have gravitationally shock-heated, hot gas bubble will have percolated, and this will maintain a hot gaseous environment, which does not favor star formation in galaxies. Okay, so that might be a reason why galaxies in filament are more passive than galaxies further away. And to check this, we need to measure gas temperature in filaments and also to check for the evolution, redshift evolution of the signal. We can also say that that the gas accretion in filaments is higher, and this gas accretion will feed efficiently the AGN at the center of the galaxy, and then this will trigger AGN feedback, which in turn will reverse the process and quench the galaxy. And to check for this, you need to investigate AGN properties in the cosmic web and also look for the redshift evolution of the signal. You can say also that maybe filaments are gas-rich and this gas is cold, but for some reason, for example, because there is a strong tidally induced shear in filaments or because of morphological quenching, I will discuss this later, gas is not efficiently injected down to the galaxy or the gas disk is stable against fragmentation. So in order to check this, we need to investigate galaxy and gas morphology and also look for the redshift evolution of the signal. So I will not go through all these propositions. I will just make a further investigation in the simulation. So I will present some work based on the Raison-AGN simulation. You all know about it, I guess. So it's a cosmological 100 megaparsec over H box side. We model gas cooling and heating, star formation, black hole growth, AGN feedback. And importantly, the simulation is run with an adaptive grid, which means that even if the low density, or so the, for example, the intergalactic medium region are not as well resolved as the high density regions, the resolution still cannot drop below the coarse grid level. In simulation, in observation, as I said, we are limited to constrain the position of the filaments because the extraction of cosmic filaments is based on the galaxy distribution. So basically, we cannot probe scales smaller than the mean intergalactic galaxy distance, which is never better than a few megaparsec in observational survey. So the measure of the distance to filaments is convolved by this few megaparsec uncertainty. So if there are some effects, some transition happening at smaller scale, this might be hidden in the noise, okay? While in the simulation, we can work directly with the dark matter particle and we can probe very small distance to filaments in the resolution limit of the simulation. So extract filaments directly from the dark matter particle distribution. And when we look at the distribution of distance to filament, which is shown here, okay, we have this bimodal distribution. So we have a population of galaxies which are on filaments and a population of galaxies which is off filaments, but here there is a gap, which was very surprising at the beginning. But in fact, this is very natural, the way the skeleton is extracted, because if you have a halo which is not on the filament, it means that the density at the filament is higher than the density at the halo location, meaning that for this halo to exist as a virialized structure, you need the density to decrease before increasing again at the halo location. So you have this kind of exclusion zone here. In the following, I will only focus on the off-population filaments, and I will look at trend when the halo approach filament. So in observation, we cannot directly look at halo mass. We have, in general, only stellar mass, but we can look at halo mass in the simulation. And here I plot everything in a 2D plane, which is distance to filament as a function of density. Distance to filament is normalized by the viral radius, but we can ignore this for now. Okay. And so we see here the mass contours in this 2D plane. So let's take a fixed distance to filament, and let's go along this dashed line, and when we increase density. And when we increase density, towards higher density, we generally have halo of larger mass. And this is something which is really expected and natural, that more massive halo live in denser environment. And this density effect is the strongest one, right? But if we fix the density and we move in the vertical direction, so you fix the density, but you look at halo which are closer and closer to filaments, you see that these contours are slanted, right? So, which is an indication that there is an additional effect of proximity to filaments on shaping halo mass on top of the density. And so you can look at this work by Marcello Musso, which confirmed that halo mass is a function of proximity to filaments and density, so from an excursion set approach. So how does look the stellar mass contours in the same plane? This is shown here. And very naturally, the stellar mass contours are very similar to the halo mass contours, with a strong effect of density. Okay. Still, if you observe it carefully, you see that the slope of the contours, in particular closer to filaments, is not the same for the halo mass and for the stellar mass. This gives an indication that there might be an additional effect of proximity to filaments on top of what is driven by halo mass. To check for this, we will compute the residual, so the excess or the deficit of stellar mass with respect to the median relation. Okay, so I compute what is the median relation here, and I look for the distance to the median relation. So this is what I call the stellar mass residual. And this is plotted in this plane. And what we see is that these galaxies here, they are a bit above the median relation. So you can interpret this as we do things at fixed halo mass, okay? So these galaxies are a bit more massive than the median than the median population, than the median mass of the population. So meaning that the stellar to halo mass ratio is a bit higher here than close to filaments, okay? So these galaxies assemble their mass a bit more efficiently in this kind of sweet spot here than very close to the filament. We can look also at the star formation rate in the same configuration, same plane, and we find a similar trend. So this is quite surprising, but it goes in the same direction as our observational result, which in which we found that passive galaxies are more close, more numerous close to filaments. How can we interpret this? Well, let's look at the gas in the halo. And first, we compute the gas distribution in the outer shell of the halo. Okay, and when we look at this, we see an excess of gas in the outer shell of the halo when we are closer to filaments. And this is not, this is expected, right? Closer to filaments, we are in an environment which is more rich in gas. What if we look at inner shell, which is shown here, and what we see here is that close to filaments, there is less gas in the inner shell than a bit further away. So this result acts like a flattening of the gas density profile when approaching filament. So this is interesting, and we can think about what can flatten the gas density profile. And one thing we can think about is to look is the specific angular momentum. Okay, so if the specific angular momentum is higher, if the specific angular momentum is higher, you can have this flattening of the gas density profile. So we look at the specific angular momentum in shells, and in the outer shells, we see that the specific angular momentum increases as getting closer to filaments. So we can easily interpret it, right, given previous works in the literatures. And so the halo will add, so the halo and the galaxy will advect angular momentum-rich material when going inside filaments. So this reflects the angular momentum content of the cosmic filaments. Let's look now at the inner part of the halo. And what we see is that at the inner part of the halo, we see this decrement of specific angular momentum at the center of the halo. So we can interpret it also in light of works from the literature. Okay, so we can interpret it as a cancellation of angular momentum, maybe due to accretion of counter-rotating stream or rapidly changing flows at the center of the filament. Or maybe we can also interpret it in light of violent disk instabilities. Okay, if we have strong inflow, probably clumpy inflow onto the galaxies, this inflow will make the disk less stable. Okay, and if the centrifugal or pressure force do not counteract the gravitational force, these clumps can collapse and drive inflow at the center of the halo while driving angular momentum outwards. If this is really what happens, we should see the formation of a bulge closer to filament. Okay, so we should see the stellar distribution become more compact. So we look at the concentration of the stellar distribution as approaching filaments, and we see indeed that the stellar distribution is more concentrated close to filaments than further away. So how can we interpret this result? So let's sketch a simple scenario when the galaxy approach filament, so it will get more and more intense and possibly clumpy gas accretion via filamentary tendrils. Okay, when entering filaments, we can have violent disk instability or counter-rotating streams, which induce this constellation of angular momentum at the center of the halo, the concentration of the stellar distribution, and the formation of a bulge. And then, these galaxies can keep quenched, even if the disk still accrete angular momentum-rich gas, because so these gas elements will move along very large orbit because they are very large. They have large angular momentum, specific angular momentum, and the presence of the bulge at the center might stabilize the disk against further fragmentation. And this is what is called in the literature morphological quenching. So in this work, we have highlighted an effect of proximity to filaments, which is, as you see, it is quite robust, whatever the density of the filaments. This is an attractive tool, though, so we cannot use directly this result to interpret our observation at redshift zero. We need to look at the evolution of this signal. But we have highlighted a quenching process which is driven only by proximity to filaments. Okay. I wanted initially to discuss what happens at the nodes of the cosmic web, but I don't think I have time, so I will just go to my last part. And I will present some forecasts for cosmic web reconstruction at higher redshift. So I have discussed some works at lower redshift. I have shown how we can extract cosmic filaments from photometric redshift, which can be extended with, in particular, Euclid and LSS6 data. But still, we will not be able to go further than redshift 1.5 or maybe 2. But at higher redshifts, we can rely on another material to trace the large-scale structure. And we can try to use the Lyman alpha forest to trace the density of neutral hydrogen. And there are several future surveys which plan to make this reconstruction here. So the idea is the following. We have a bunch of background sources, so either bright quasars or bright star-forming galaxies, which emit strongly in the blue, and the neutral hydrogen clouds in front of these sources will induce absorption at the Lyman alpha wavelengths. And because each gas cloud see the background sources redshifted, we will in turn have this Lyman alpha forest, so this series of absorption. The transmitted flux along the line of sight can be used as a proxy for the neutral hydrogen density. So now, if we have a lot of these background sources, so we have a lot of sight lines, we can basically interpolate between the sight lines to get a 3D distribution of the matter. So if we do the interpolation through Wiener filtering, okay, we can predict what is the density field, knowing our data vector, assuming a prior form for the covariance matrix. And basically, the resolution of the reconstruction will be set by the mean inter-sightlines distance. Okay? So what is the mean inter-sightlines distance for the future surveys? So we will have soon with QSO data. So this is a quasar survey, which means that the sample of sources is relatively sparse with respect to galaxies. And so we can hope to make a reconstruction at scale of 10 to the 20 megaparsec. This is super large scale, but this is good enough to, for example, make cosmological measurements based on the topology of the density field. I will just show briefly a forecast for the reconstruction with MOSAIC on the ELT. So MOSAIC is planned to be a second generation instrument on the ELT, and we will use MOSAIC in the blue, where we have two possible observing modes. And so I will make reconstruction for these modes. This is the current, I mean, it was the state of the ELT in September 2019, so with the construction of the dome has started, so it should be much more advanced now. In order to consistently implement the noise in the reconstruction with the noise on the spectra and the correct distribution of background sightlines, we make forecasts based on the horizon agent simulated light cone. And in the light cone, we can predict what will be the Lyman alpha transmitted flux along the line of sight given the true gas distribution. And we consistently implement the Lyman alpha fluorescence in the spectra, and we add noise given the specification of the mosaic instrument. I show here some examples of the reconstruction. So we look here at between redshift 3 and 3.5. This is the original field. And this is the reconstructed field through the Lyman alpha tomography with different signal to noise ratio on the spectra. So here we use a spectra resolution of 2000, so which is lower than the nominal resolution of the mosaic instrument, which means that we rebeam the spectra. And the signal to noise ratio here is as per resolution element. And the purpose of this work is to try to set a lower limit on which signal to noise ratio is acceptable, which resolution and signal to noise ratio is acceptable to get a sufficiently good resolution for the measurement of for the cosmic web studies. So we can make a first comparison of the density at each in each pixel of the reconstructed field versus the density in the original field, almost at the same scale. I will not enter in the detail of this comparison. What I would like to show is the effect of the non-uniform distribution of background sight lines, okay? Because we are looking at bright background sources. These bright sources are clustered, which means that we don't have a uniform distribution of sight lines. And this induces shot noise in the reconstruction. If you compare this dark blue curve and this light blue curve, you see directly this effect of this shot noise. Okay, for these curves, there is no noise on the spectra. The only things which change is the distribution of the sources. Okay, and you see that you increase a lot the scatter when you have the non-uniform distribution. Then we can check the effect of the noise on the spectra, so varying the signal-to-noise ratio. And this is interesting because you see that above signal-to-noise ratio of 6, you do not really increase the quality of the reconstruction. The green and the orange curve, so 6 and 10, are almost overlapping because at that point, you start to be limited by the shot noise, so this effect of non-uniform background sources distribution. I talked about galaxy transformation as approaching filaments, so we can try to see if we recover this signal from our reconstructed field, which is, in a sense, a test of the quality of the reconstruction. So I haven't presented this result in observation, but here we look at mass gradients towards filaments, so increasing mass when getting closer to filaments. Assuming we have synergy with GWST, for example, so we can get magnitude in the J, absolute magnitude in the J band, which can be taken as a proxy for mass, we can look at how the mass increases as approaching filament. And this test, if we quantify this, so the difference of the this gradient curve with respect to a random distribution, we can say that the signal-to-noise ratio of 4 is a minimum to measure mass gradients towards filaments. So with this work, we can we can try to define the planning of the survey. What does it mean, signal-to-noise ratio of 4 with mosaic? It means that we will. It requires to observe each source, I mean the faintest source, about 3.7 hours, which is quite a lot, right? And depending on the mode of the observation, so VIFU is not really competitive, but the highly multiplexed MOS spectrograph gives quite good results. So we need to observe the sky. So this is for planning for 1 square degree field about 24 hours, right? Number in parentheses is in the bad sky, bad seeing condition. So this is quite costly in terms of observation time, but I would like to advocate that this is really worth making it. We can really make progress on understanding the galaxy transformation if we look things in the context of the cosmic web. Plus, if we get this 3D reconstruction of the density field, we can also use it to make topological measurements, for example, to probe the impact of baryons, of agent feedback on the density field, so to put constraint on agent feedback. So I have no time to discuss this. I will just jump to my conclusion. So I have shown that galaxy populations do not carry all the same information about the large-scale structure, right? Passive galaxies are more close to the filament backbone than star-forming galaxies, for example. We have numerous observational works now suggesting that galaxy mass assembly is shaped by proximity to filament on top of what is already driven by halo mass and density. And we confirm this based on hydrodynamical simulation. I didn't have time to talk about the groups. And the last point is that future Lyman alpha surveys could provide a reconstruction of the density field at the scale of few megaparsec up to redshift 3 to 3.5, which is very promising. Thank you.
Very nice work, Clotilde. I'm admirative. So I have a point of detail and then another question. So the point of detail is when you showed on slide 15 the PDF of the distances to the filaments with two peaks.
Yeah.
One was very small at about 2 kiloparsecs, and one was at 1 megaparsec. And so I was surprised by the numbers because I remember people like Avishai Dekel and Johan Dubois telling me that I always ask them, how big are the filaments? Of course, what do you mean by size? You know, it's a difficult question. Mm-hmm. But they would argue that it depends on the redshift. But at redshift, so you're looking at the cosmos field. So that's redshift 1, I guess, right?
Yeah, between 0.5 and 0.9.
They basically say it's close to the, it's roughly of order of the virial radius of the galaxies on which the filaments fall on. Mm-hmm. And so that's much higher than the 2 kiloparsecs. That you're getting. So what you're finding is that the filaments have density profiles that are pretty steep inside somehow. The cylindrical density profiles.
So sorry, 2 kiloparsec, you see it on this distribution or?
No, it was on slide 15.
Ah, so this is on the simulation.
Ah, was it?
This is not Cosmos. Here.
This one, yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is a simulation?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so I was amazed that with the observations you could get this.
No, okay. Yeah. This is my point, right? In observation, we cannot probe very small distances. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So that's why we turn to simulations.
But still, so the filaments are, you know, the minimum of this population is at 30 kiloparsecs. So the filaments are typically, under simulation, they're defined structures narrower than 30 kiloparsecs, which is much smaller than the virial radius of a galaxy.
So, yeah, I mean, it depends on which scale you look at. I mean, it depends on the scale, right? So you have filaments at all scales. So
yes,
if you extract only very large-scale filaments, mm-hmm. you will mm-hmm. find distance to filaments much larger than...
Mm-hmm. So you can, yeah, so this function depends on the threshold at which you define filaments
dispersed. Yeah, so, I mean, the true question behind that is which scale matters for galaxy formation.
Exactly,
right?
Good. So my question is, so you mentioned the different reasons why the physical properties of galaxy, like their star formation rate, depends on both density and the distance of the filament, and you mentioned among one possibility AGN, so of course I could not resist asking, did you compare the horizon AGN and horizon no AGN simulations to look at that effect?
We haven't done it really yet.
Sorry?
We haven't done it in this work. Oh, okay. What I can say is that Katarina Kraljic made a complementary work on horizon agent simulation as well, and she looks at the effect of agent feedback. I mean, how the effect of agent feedback change as going towards filaments, and if I remember correctly, the effect is stronger when going towards the filament, towards the filament location.
But without AGM, if you look at it, and do you still get how
would
you get AGM?
Your question is, does she get a population of passive galaxies close to filaments without AGN, is your question? Not really, but she didn't look at this small scale, okay? She smoothed the field the density field is smooth at a bit larger scale, so this effect might be hidden in this smoothing. What I show is something happening at quite small scale here.
Okay. Thank you very much, Clotilde, for this very nice talk. I think it's a hope to join the two expertises of this laboratory, which is numerical simulation for galaxy formation and our evolution models. We have a lot of this kind of models in this institute. The point is, you are separate passive and active galaxies. But passive means for you one category. You don't have several star formation, and how can you explain a very high redshift at redshift 8 and 9? We are publishing a paper on redshift 8, and it is not the same category for passive galaxies. That is the first question, and the second question, you can choose the order. It's a Lyman-Bragg galaxy. You don't mention any point about that.
Yeah, thank you very much for your comment. And you are perfectly right, okay? We can refine the study by looking at Lyman-Bragg galaxies or by looking at how passive galaxies are different as a function of redshift, and we need to do that. That's completely right. What I show is a first study, right? It's a first step. And the first step is to broadly separate star-forming and passive galaxies.
We know the quenching. I don't believe to the quenching. You don't understand that. We believe to the simulation, not to the quenching. So I think it is not evident.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have a question about your predictions for the ELT observations. You are
okay.
Referring several times signal to noise of 4, but to what is that referring to? To the signal to noise in the spectra? And what?
Yes.
How does it affect because the accuracy of the redshift, or what are you using in the spectra?
So this is the signal to noise of the spectra, and this is a signal to noise per resolution element on the spectra.
Yeah, but depending on the galaxy, if there is only continuum or whether you have emission lines, it completely changes the accuracy. So.
Right, so this is signal to noise of the spectra on the continuum close to the Lyman alpha forest regions.
Could you please say something about groups since you didn't have time to do it?
I can say, just a word maybe. Two words, okay. So we did this work in Cosmos when we correlate the position of X-ray detected groups with the filaments extracted from the galaxy distribution. And we look at this very basic quantity, which is the connectivity, so how many filaments are connected to the groups. Okay. So for example, here we have 2 filaments, so this is connectivity 2. Here we have 4 filaments, this connectivity 4. And we look at how connectivity, how the properties of the group and the properties of the central galaxy scales with connectivity. And in particular, we did this as a fixed group mass. Okay, so I will just show this. And we found that connectivity of the groups with a passive population of central galaxy is higher at all mass, at all group mass, than the ones which have a star-forming central. One scenario we advance for that, there might be several scenarios, right? But I would like to emphasize this one. So what's the way to grow a group in mass? Well, let's assume you have a group which is connected to three filaments. It can grow in mass through smooth accretion along these filaments. And then we increase the group mass, but we don't increase the connectivity. Another path to grow the group is through a measure. And let's assume each of these groups is connected to three filaments. They will merge, they will grow in mass, and then you get four filaments as a result. So you increase the connectivity. And we argue that it's much easier to keep star-forming galaxies if you don't have a recent major merger. So in this case, it's much easier to keep the star-forming galaxies than in this case, which might be the explanation for what is, we see.
One question about Mosaic. Your reconstruction seems to be working very well up to 3.3 and then be much... And just looking at my eye here, previous slide, much worse after 3.3. Is there a reason for that?
Okay, this is a good point. We make a cut in apparent magnitude in the R band to target the background sources. So which means that basically we'll have more sources. So more sight lines at lower redshift than at higher redshift, which might be a reason why the quality change as a function of redshift.
Maybe I'll just ask a quick question. You had a slice which was describing different scenarios. So what's your current bet?
There is not only one scenario, probably. It is my bet. And okay. Anyway, from what I have shown in the simulation, this last scenario is, at least is present in what we see. Okay, so the formation of the bulge, the compaction of the galaxy, and then the quenching because we have a stable disk which does not fragment anymore in filament. And yeah.
If there are no more questions, let's thank Clotilde once again.